So, boys and girls, we've been so excited for this day to come. We've all been enjoying the one and only Ivan. And our special guest is here, Katherine Applegate. Before she starts her presentation, we have something, Katherine, that we wanted to welcome you with. One of our fifth grades has done something special. So I'm going to give the mic over to Mrs. Turcott, our music teacher, who has done this with the children.
Welcome. I have to say, I've read your book twice. I'll probably read it two more times. I love how Bob's my favorite character. All right, so what we did was, I'm always going online to find new ideas that I can implement the Common Core standards with, not compromising the music curriculum, but kind of marrying them together. So I went on a teaching channel, and I found something called Creating Found Poems. And it's actually a lesson plan for 9th to 12th grade classes. But I thought, I'm going to choose one of my 5th grade classes to do this project. So what we did was we broke into 6 groups of 4 students in each group. Mm-hmm. And each group had a different colored marker. So I knew the green group, the red group, the purple group. And that way I could assess who did the work. And what we did was, this is kind of the outcome of it. We made little strips. And then I invited the students to come up and put them in the order that they wanted the poem to be in. And they said, well, we want it to flow. And I was like, okay, what grade are you in? Sound wonderful. And so I told them after they left, because we only had a half an hour to do this, that I would tweak the poem a little bit. Now, a found poem, you have to use a text. So we used The One and Only Ivan by Kathy Applegate as the place where we would find phrases. And then we had a special theme, and the theme was patience and determination, because one of your chapters is patience. So we decided we would look for lines that you had written in the book and come up with a poem. So without further ado, I don't want to take more time away from Ms. Applegate. Mrs. Sullivan, I'll turn the class over to you, and they're going to read for you the poem that they had written. Found Poems.
It was a great book. We enjoyed reading it a lot. We hope that you continue as a writer and keep writing these amazing kinds of books.
Love, Room 21 of Prudence Crandall School, 5th grade.
You guys already made me cry, and I just got here. Oh, that was beautiful, beautiful.
Okay, boys and girls, can we welcome Katherine Applegate?
Oh, wow, what a great way to start. That was just beautiful, and you really did make me cry, so stop. but it's so incredibly moving when you're a writer. Because think about it, I sit in a room all by myself and I don't see a single person except my dog and my cat, and occasionally my children will pass through, and my husband. And I don't see my readers, and I'm writing for these imaginary people. And then when I come to a school and I see that my story has meant something to you in some tangible way, it is, oh, it's the coolest part of being a writer. It's amazing. I'm going to tell you a little bit today about what it's like to be a writer, and maybe even what it's like to be a gorilla, although we're guessing on that one. And to do that, I need you guys to stop being students for about 10, 15 minutes. I want you to become gorillas. Yes, there will be chest beating later. And the reason you're going to do this, guys, is because in order to write a book about a gorilla, I had to go into Ivan's head. And I knew nothing about gorillas. I had written this series called Animorphs about kids who can turn into animals. I wrote it with my husband. And we did a little bit of gorilla stuff, but I honestly knew nothing about gorillas. I love animals, not a big gorilla person. So I had to figure out what it was like to be a gorilla, or I couldn't write first-person gorilla, a story from the point of view of a gorilla. So I'm going to show you some stuff along the way. Some of you will have seen some of these clips, and I apologize if it's redundant. But I want to give you a sense of how the book came together, and that always starts with the book trailer. Book trailers, like those little movies they make about books these days, and in the old days, I've been writing like 20 years now, they didn't make book trailers. But what happens now is either the author will make them themselves, or in this case, I sent the book to a little tiny company in Los Angeles, and they read it, and they took the art, and the only contribution I had to make was, what did I want the music to sound like? And I said, well, if it's a gorilla, it probably would sound like a cello, maybe, kind of a low, sad sound. And after all, Ivan's story was kind of sad, and that's how they picked the music.
Thank you.
Okay. This is what I want you guys to do. I want you to go very, very zen. I don't want you thinking about other stuff, because that's what you have to do when you're a writer. That means you're not thinking about how boring the speech is, although it may have dull moments, and you're not thinking about all the homework you had this weekend, because I know your teachers would not do that to you. And you're not thinking about sensory input. You're not thinking about the outside world, because you're becoming gorillas. That means you're not thinking about the guy who just farted two rows up. You are focusing on your internal self, because you are becoming a gorilla. I do not mean that kind of gorilla, by the way. That is the Hollywood gorilla. By the way, they are going to make Ivan into a movie, so we will see if it's if it turns out to be that kind of gorilla or the kind of gorilla we ended up knowing. It's going to be Disney is going to make the movie. I mean that kind of gorilla. Now that is a cute baby Western lowland gorilla. That is you, okay? For the next few minutes, you are living in Central Africa, having a pretty good life. I think actually baby gorillas are cuter than humans. They're really quite adorable. When they get big, they get kind of interesting looking. But okay, so I need to know some stuff, right? I need to know some basics about gorilla behavior. And mind you, I knew nothing about gorillas, nothing. So the first thing I have to know, how do you move? Does anyone know what that's called when you do that? Yeah, knuckle walking. You knuckle walk. It's a very sturdy way to get around the jungle. You'll notice you have a very large butt. That's okay. You're pure muscle. You're like 400 pounds of pure muscle. You need that muscle. This is how you say, hey, look at me. Now, that, I'm going to have you do this in a minute, but I want to tell you the trick. That is a juvenile, so he's just kind of learning how. If you're a full-fledged silverback, you have air sacs in your neck, and it creates a reverberation, and you get a lot of sound. And it travels through the jungle very effectively. So the other thing you can do, since you lack those, is cup your palms. So I want you guys to try. Let's hear some serious chest beating. Oh, come on. That is really lame. All right, all right. Now we're getting some tone. All right, all right. Okay, so you just said, hey, guys, look at me. I'm going to teach you some others. The thing about gorillas is they communicate in myriad ways. They grunt, they pant, they hoot, they purr, believe it or not. I thought that was so fascinating. Who knew gorillas purred? One of my favorites is the pig snort. Okay, let's. Nice, very nice. What you just said, if you were a mom or dad gorilla, was, kids, cut it out. That is how a mom or dad says, okay, I've had enough. I'm turning this car around. That's gorilla talk. So they have tons of ways to communicate, but much of it is body language. And that's going to come up later when I show you this really interesting clip. The thing to know about communication is it's as vital to gorillas as it is to humans. And that's why you have to know this stuff if you're going to be writing about a gorilla. Okay, this is gorilla recess. Can you see okay? You can, if anybody can't see, just feel free to, you know, move around. Okay. Oh, well, that would help. How's that? I just want to make sure everybody can see okay. Let me show you that again. This is a juvenile again, and they will do this all day long. And what's really great is that in the jungle you have vegetation, you know? It's like having a trampoline. It's so cool. And they will do that all day. Gorillas play. And if you go online, you can find tape, this is so cool, of them playing tag. And I swear to you, it looks exactly like kids playing tag. It's like, not it, not it, and they hide. It's really remarkable when you start seeing gorilla behavior, how very much it mimics human behavior. Or maybe we're mimicking them, who knows? So this is your diet. You like bananas. You like mangoes. You like leaves. It gets worse. You like bark. And this is a gorilla delicacy, believe it or not. the termite. Yeah. A little protein in the diet. But basically, you're a vegetarian. So remember this. Those of you who are writers, and there are a lot of you in this room, I guarantee you, you need to know these kinds of things. Most writers, when they start writing a book, they do a character biography, and we sit down, and it's like you're interviewing an imaginary person, or in this case, imaginary animal. And you say, what do you like to eat? What are your hobbies? What are you afraid of? What makes you happy? You got to know what people like to eat, or in this case, gorillas. Okay, this is your family. It's kind of an extended family. You have dads. Gorillas are very old-fashioned. They think guys are the boss. And that guy is a silverback. Then you have a few females, usually two or three, in a, what's called a troop, a family. And then you have juveniles, called blackbacks if they're male. And you have babies. And it can be quite a large group. This is how you hang out with your siblings. And they're wrestling, but they're also learning about dominance. Dominance, just like it is in human society, is a very important part of gorilla society. You need to know who's the boss. You need to know who the teacher is, who the principal is. And in this case, this is one way they do it. They play. This is mom. Now, remember, you're a baby Western lowland gorilla, whose name is going to turn out eventually to be Ivan. You would have had a female next to you on mom's back. Ivan, we think, had a twin. It may have been an orphaned female from another troop who was brought in, because gorillas will do that. Or it could have been another female from the same troop, from a different mother. We don't really know for sure. So there would have been two of you on mom's back. Mom will walk around like this. The kids will do it as long as they can get away with it. And then when the mom gets tired of it, she kind of shrugs them off and they go flying. But now this is dad. Dad is very important to the troop. Dad is 400 pounds of pure muscle. He has literally the strength of 8 men. These guys are enormously powerful. And that's, I think, why humans are so terrified of them and why we came up with, you know, King Kong. Because look at them. But they're actually very peaceful, gentle creatures. This guy has one job. And remember this. This is very important. To protect his family. And presumably, Ivan's dad was doing a pretty good job of that until these guys came along. Do you know what they're called? Yeah. Poachers. And poaching is a huge problem in Africa. Animals are killed for body parts. Rhinos for horn, elephants for tusks. Believe it or not, they kill gorillas and they take their hands and they make them into ashtrays. Sometimes animals are killed for meat. It's called bush meat. Sometimes for their pelts, for fur. Sometimes they're captured when they're young for people's own amusement. And that's what happened to Ivan. Poaching is a huge problem, and there isn't an easy solution because these guys are often incredibly poor themselves, trying to feed their own families. One solution that people have come up with is called ecotourism, where people go to Africa, and these very people who were killing the animals are instead guarding them in preserves. And it's a slow change, but it's a change that's starting, and it's a hopeful change. So, unfortunately for Ivan, he and that little female were put in a cage. We don't know what happened to the family, but presumably they were killed. And Ivan and this little female were sent to, of all places, Tacoma, Washington. I actually went to the B&I Mall, and if you look up here at the very, very top, there is a picture of a gorilla, and that is Ivan. This place is still in existence. It's kind of like a flea market mall. It's got an arcade. They sell used tires. They sell clothes. They have cotton candy. It's really weird. And they have a pet store. And I went there with my kids and snuck around behind the scenes where Ivan's cage used to be. They still have it. And I took pictures. And I felt very James Bond while I did it. And it's really an interesting place. So this guy, the guy who owned this, there were actually two men, had it in the 30s. And a circus broke down, a little traveling circus. right near here, and they didn't know what to do with all their animals, so the guy who owned the mall said, hey, I'll take a few in, it'll be good for business. It was really, really good for business. And he kept adding animals over the years. He ordered Ivan and that little female like you'd order a pair of shoes. And they showed up after a long and horrific trip, and there they are. That is Ivan on the left, and poor Burma died shortly after arriving of pneumonia. It was probably so traumatic. The trip was probably so awful. But Ivan actually thrived. And he went to live with this guy. This is the caretaker of the mall. And what's so weird about this, he lived there in the guy's house for maybe 2 or 3 years. And the man had an 8-year-old son, and Ivan slept in his bed every single night. Can you imagine sleeping with a baby gorilla? And Ivan lived in the house. You notice on this picture, he's wearing diapers because it's difficult to potty train gorillas, apparently. And he has a cast on his toe because he was swinging off the chandelier and he broke his toe. He would do, you know, he could open the refrigerator. He liked to drink Pepsis. They would hold out his lower lip and pour in Pepsis. He watched TV. He rode motorcycles. He played with babies. He went to baseball games. When they would go to McDonald's, they'd put him in a convertible and order fries for their kid in the back seat, and he'd be wearing a little outfit, and then they'd pull up, and it wouldn't be a little boy in the back seat, it would be a gorilla, and of course the clerk would freak out. So eventually everybody in Tacoma knew about Ivan. Ivan became a local celebrity. He had this annoying habit, though. He kept growing and growing and eating and eating. And humans have this thing about big gorillas, as we've discussed. So what did they do? They put him in a cage at the mall, and he lived there for 27 years. Now, this cage had like 3 sections. It kind of grew and changed over time. The largest was like a 14 by 14 foot cement cell area. They painted jungle scene on the wall. He had a little water feature for a while. There was glass so that people could come and visit him. And this became a thing to do if you lived in the area. You would go to the B&I Mall on the weekends. And I've talked to so many people, they're grown-ups now, who did this for years, that every weekend you'd go say hi to Ivan. He loved kids. He would come up to the glass and high-five them. And he would roll up poop and throw it at them. This is a fun thing for primates to do, apparently. And he really responded well to kids. He didn't seem to like men. He really liked women. He had some female caretakers. They were blonde. Later in life, one of his caretakers actually had to dye her hair black because he loved blonde hair so much he was always pulling on it. So that was his existence for almost 3 decades. This is Ivan a little bit older and a little bit sadder. As he got older, he became less involved with humans who came to watch him, and he would just stare at that wall and pound on it all day. And it's the saddest thing to see, because that was his life. So I came across this story. You know, you always ask, this is like the ultimate author question, where do you get your ideas? Well, their authors have plenty of ideas, and believe me, so do you. Because all you have to do is say, what if, and put 2 words together. Give me a word. Anybody. Give me a noun, like cat or dog or dog. Okay. Give me another noun, like, yeah.
Fish.
Okay, so what if a dog turned into a fish? Okay, you have a story. That's how easy it is, okay? So next time your teacher says, yeah, I can't, you're telling her, I can't think of anything to write, and she's saying, of course you can think of something to write. All you have to do is say, what if, plug in a couple words, and you have a story. So I didn't have any trouble coming up with ideas, but this one really stuck with me. And when I saw this article, Gorilla Sulks in Tacoma Mall as His Future is Debated, I thought, okay, there is a wonderful story there, a horrible story, a bizarre story. I'm going to tell it. And I cut it out and I put it in a box, because that's what I did. I have an idea box, and I'll write something on a napkin or a post-it note, and I'll throw it in there, because you never know what might come back and become a good story. This one took a long time, over a decade, but I went back to it. Then I found out about this National Geographic documentary called The Urban Gorilla, and I think some of you may have seen this. I'm going to show you a little clip from it.
For another urban gorilla, there's not yet been a happy ending.
At the Beanbag Shopping Center and its cash registers and shopping carts, inside two conference rooms and a trailer just beyond the sporting goods, lives a 400-pound silverback gorilla named Ivan. Ivan's been at the Beanbag for 24 years.
So this next man who's talking in this documentary was, I actually met his sister. He was an anthropologist. He lived in the area, and he talked the mall owner into letting him go into Ivan's cage, which was kind of a brave thing to do when you think about it. And he wanted Ivan to have some kind of stimulation. He was so bored. So the first thing he came up with was finger painting. Ivan turned out to really like finger painting. He also liked thumb painting and nose painting and tongue painting. He was known to eat the paint, but that's okay. He had something to do, and they actually auctioned one of his illustrations off for $5,000. So this is actually, I'm going to pass this around. This was taken by Ivan's keeper much later in his life. And you'll notice he has a lot of blue paint in his mouth. There's a reason for that. But this is one of his finger paintings as he was. So you can just pass that around. So this guy would do other things. He would take a banana and he'd put it on the end of a string on a fishing pole and he would like dangle it in front of Ivan so Ivan would have something to do and he'd grab at it like a little yellow bird. So he's talking right now about his hopes for Ivan's future, but at this point, nobody thought Ivan would ever, ever leave this cage.
If anything were possible with Ivan, anything could come true, I would like to see Ivan in an outdoor compound. I would like to see Ivan with true, real, solid education. I would like to see Ivan be in the field of these things that he's been in the education before. And I would like to see Ivan, most importantly, with the world.
A victim of circumstance, Ivan lives out his solitary days at the Beanbag. The sad reminder of a less enlightened era when gorillas were seen as nothing more than exotic attractions.
That clip always makes me so sad because that was his life, staring at that wall, pounding on it, just waiting for some human to realize that this was not an okay existence for an animal. So I saw this story. I wanted to tell it. I did a lot of research. And I figured I knew how to do it, because I've written a lot of books. I've written over like 150 books, a lot of them with my husband. We did all kinds of series. We did Disney books. I did what's called ghostwriting, where your name isn't even on the book. I did something called Sweet Valley, the twins that some of the mothers will, you hear the mothers going, oh, it's because they used to read Sweet Valley. Not the best books in the world, but they were, they served a purpose. Jessica was the evil twin. So, I had written a lot of books, and among them, as I said, was Animorphs, which my husband and I wrote together. And so we've done some animal research. I figured I knew how to do this, right? But I knew I was going to make a few mistakes, and it turned out I did. That is my official author photo. I want you all to memorize it because that is what being a writer is like. It's about making mistakes. You wear pajamas to work. You make stuff up. And you make a lot of mistakes. So basically, I'm paid to be a liar and a slob. It's a really cool job. But you have to know that you are going to make a lot of mistakes. And I had my kids crumple up a whole bunch of typewriter paper for that. Usually, I'm pushing the delete key. It's okay to make mistakes when you write, but I didn't know that. And I got really frustrated with this book. And at one point, I actually decided to stop writing it. And I had this little piece of paper, a note I'd written to myself. And it says, the question is, do I give up on Ivan or not? Because I just knew it wasn't working. And I kept going, and it turned out to be an okay book. So I'm really glad I stuck with it. And remember that when you get frustrated, especially with writing, but with anything you're trying to do that's new, because it's hard. I thought for a long time about the kind of gorilla I wanted. I was going to write a character named Ivan. What was he going to be like? Was he going to be like this? or like this. I was thinking about all the gorillas I'd ever encountered in my life, and then I came up with this kind of Ivan. This is an illustration from the book, and I love the way he looks so sensitive and calm and patient, because I thought the illustrator really got that across. Her name is Patricia Castileo, and she lives in Portugal, and I've never met her, but I thought she did a wonderful job picturing what Ivan might really look like. So I had Ivan. I needed someone for Ivan to talk to, right? That's called an interlocutor. And we needed one really badly in this book because Ivan's stuck in a cage for 30 years. So it's not a real action-packed adventure, is it? Bob was very helpful for that. Bob started out as a roach, and he was a mouse, and he was a rat. I needed somebody really little bitty to get in the cage. And since I was fictionalizing the story, I realized, well, you know, I could make the hole a little bigger and the dog a little smaller. And that's how Bob was born. And the weird thing is, he looks exactly like my own dog, Stan. There's a picture out there in the hallway. And it's remarkable. The illustrator had never seen my dog. I just had that little description of him, that he had big ears and he was small. And I saw it, when I first saw it, I was shocked because it was like she had somehow stolen Stan's picture. It was, my own dog is equally bratty and sarcastic, so it was a good match. Then I needed a human, because I needed someone to help tell the story and interact with the world. My own daughter was about 10 at the time. Her name is Julia. You'll notice the book is dedicated to Julia, and the main character's name is Julia, and that's no coincidence. And my daughter has long, dark hair and likes art. So that's where Julia came from. Then I needed a voice, and the voice is so important when you're writing fiction. It's how you sound. And different books will have a different sound. I wanted this book to be really spare. I didn't want a lot of words. I thought Ivan wouldn't have a lot to say because he was a gorilla. He seemed like a majestic, quiet creature, and he'd been stuck in a cage all those years. Also, I like to write small. And so this is not just, as you know, the first three lines of Ivan. This is the first chapter. And when I tell kids that's the first chapter, they're always very excited, because all that white space and all the illustrations mean it's a really quick read. And that's what I wanted. So then I needed a motivation, because if characters don't change in books, they're really boring. And that was Ruby. Now, I know that there was a real elephant at the B&I Mall, briefly, a baby elephant. She got into paint and got the paint all over the store. That's all I know. So I decided to use that little bit of information, and I created Ruby and Stella. Then I needed a way for Ivan to help Ruby, and I decided to use the fact, as you are seeing from that photograph, that he liked to finger paint and he liked art. So I took all the little data bits I'd come up with about the real Ivan story, and that's how I put them into the mix. And that part is really fun, but it's also frustrating, because sometimes the story bits don't fit together quite the way you want them to. So I had all that, and I was doing pretty well. And then remember I told you I got really frustrated at one point, so I decided to do research. Research, I am such a good procrastinator. I don't recommend this strategy, but sometimes when I get frustrated, I procrastinate. And so I like to do research because it's so fun and you find out so much. And that's when I came across the story of Yambo, who ends up in the book. Yambo, it's spelled J-A-M-B-O, was a real gorilla. And he lived in a European zoo. And he was minding his own business one day when a little boy named Levin Merritt, who was 5 years old, just happened to fall into his enclosure, which is not a good idea. Yambo had one job, right? He's a silverback. He has to protect his family. He's never seen this little boy. They rarely had humans other than the keepers even in the enclosure. Behind Yambo are females and babies and juveniles, and he has one job, and it is to get rid of that boy, and everybody watching thought that Levin Merritt was going to be killed. So watch what Yambo does. And as you watch it, you need to remember that sometimes the way gorillas communicate with each other is through body language. So if Yambo positions himself in such a way that he's between the troop and the boy, or if he sits quietly, he's signaling the other gorillas to behave the same way.
5-year-old Levin Merritt lay unconscious at the mercy of a 450-pound silverback gorilla. The crowd watched helplessly. Never before had such an accident occurred.
and never before had the sole-grown male gorilla encountered a human being within his domain. Only the worst could be imagined. But what was to unfold this September afternoon for the sun shone? As the injured child regained consciousness, tension turned to panic. But Yama, the Western Roman gorilla, shattered an age-old myth. Prisoner in a world where man is king, he shone an astonishing sensitivity for human life. Never man has rushed to a hospital with only minor injuries. But the incident had given us a rare glimpse into the nature of this extraordinary animal.
I thought that story was so bizarre that I included it in the book. And that's what happens when you do research. Sometimes you'll find these interesting little data bits. And I had Stella tell this story about this gorilla to Ivan. And I was talking about this in Chicago to some kids, and they raised their hand and they said, "Oh, no, that was our zoo. That happened at our zoo." And I said, no, that was a whole different zoo. But it did happen at the Brookfield Zoo in Chicago. Another kid fell into an enclosure, and the same thing happened. This female cradled this kid in her arms. She had a baby on her back. At the time, she had been trained to take her baby to a little window where the baby would be weighed and measured by the zookeepers, and she carried this kid over to this window. It was just amazing. So I included that. It changed the way I wrote the book, and then I started doing research about elephants. And how many of you have been to a circus? See, I used to go to the circus all the time when I was little, and I thought it was so cool to see the wild animals and in that environment, and it never occurred to me that it might not be the happiest thing in the world. Here, I'm trying to get out of the way. In the world for the poor elephants. So I started doing some research about it. And it turns out it's not a lot of fun. Here's the thing about elephants. They travel in huge matriarchal groups. That's a bunch of females. The guys go off and start their own lives. They travel miles and miles every day on the savannah. They seem to behave like families. They have emotional, what appear to observers to be emotional reactions to each other. When an elephant dies, the other elephants grieve. When one is in trouble, they go get others to help. And when you take these very tight-knit families and destroy the bonds and pull an elephant out of there and put her in a trailer and chain her leg to the floor for as much as 22 hours a day, and sometimes train with what's called a bull hook, which is a very sharp stick, it's not a lot of fun if you're an elephant. And I did not realize that, and I didn't know about it until I started doing research about circus elephants, because I had decided to add Stella and Ruby, and it changed the way I wrote the book again, and it changed the way I felt about circuses. So again, research became a way to form the book in new and different ways. But the most important research I had to do was to find out what happened to Ivan. There he is. He's middle-aged at that point. I think that's the best photo I've seen of him, because it kind of perfectly encapsulates what his life was like, just sitting there, staring out at the world, hoping somebody will come save him. And guess who came and saved him? kids like you. And that's what's so cool about this. Kids like you got really, really mad. And they started making posters, and they started writing letters to the editor, and then the mayor, and then the governor. They had petitions. They, most importantly, started boycotting the mall. They told their parents they didn't want to go anymore. And it took a long time. This mall had to go into bankruptcy before Ivan was finally released to Zoo Atlanta on permanent loan. And I always tell kids, zoos are not a perfect answer. I mean, a perfect answer would be that we wouldn't be in the situation that animals would be roaming free, but it's not that easy. Second best answer is a preserve where animals have a huge amount of space to roam. But there are good zoos. Some zoos do research, and they educate, and they work on preservation of species, and Zoo Atlanta was that kind of zoo. And they had the largest collection of Western lowland gorillas in the country, and they took Ivan in. And he saw grass and trees and sun, and most importantly, other gorillas for the first time in almost 30 years. Now, it was not an easy transition. I love that picture of Ivan. He looks like he's smiling. And that whole, I think, is a bald spot. It happens to older gorillas. It took a while for Ivan to figure out how to be a gorilla again. Remember how they communicate in all kinds of interesting ways? Well, he didn't know how to do that anymore. So they had him watch the other gorillas on closed-circuit TV. And when they thought he was ready, you know, remember how gorillas are kind of, you know, old-fashioned. So they thought, let's get a couple of little bitty females. He can handle that, no problem. He's a silverback. And they put Ivan in the room with the two little bitty females. And those girls chased him around the room. He was terrified. They had to pull him out. It was very humiliating for poor Ivan. But he finally started to get the hang of it. He ended up having a girlfriend named Kenyani, who does appear in the book. And they never had children. But he was beloved by the other juveniles at the zoo. They would come up and they would climb on him, and he was very tolerant, and he was always the silliest, weirdest, quirkiest gorilla of the bunch. One day somebody brought in a sombrero, you know, a big old hat, and all the other gorillas were terrified of it because, you know, they weren't used to wearing human clothing. But Ivan, of course, had no problem wearing hats. So he wore it all day, and all the gorillas were like, you know, there's something wrong with this guy. And then he ate the middle of it and wore it around his neck like a necklace. Some other person brought in a big stuffed gorilla for Ivan to play with. Again, the other gorillas were terrified. He put it in his nest, because gorillas build kind of primitive nests each night, and he carried it around with him, and it was like his best friend for a few days. And then one day, his keeper, Jody Kerrigan, said she was watching him, and it was like he clicked and realized, whoa, I am a gorilla. I don't do stuffed animals. That's a human thing. And he slapped it like this, and then he yanked the head off and tossed it over his shoulder. He was like, okay, I'm out of here. I'm done. I'm a gorilla again. I don't do stuffed animals. So he was always very quirky and very human-centered to the end. The caretaker, Jody, was his best friend. He adored her. And they spent many, many hours together. But he did seem to remember how to be a gorilla. And he really did seem happier. This is the closest I got to actually meeting Ivan. I went to the zoo with my poor daughter. It was raining. Ivan hated wet weather. He hated wet weather so much that he would take a burlap coffee bag. You know how little kids will carry around, babies will carry a blanket around with them? Well, Ivan had a big burlap coffee bag, and that was his blankie. And when he went outside, because he hated wet grass, he would stick it under his butt, and then he would like slide around on the grass, on the blanket, because he didn't want to get wet. And so I knew when I got there and it was raining that Ivan would not come out. But I sat there in the rain with my daughter for like 3 hours, and she said, Mom, can we go now? And so we did. But a librarian I know named John Schumacher was able to take my book to the zoo and go back behind the scenes. And to do that, you have to put on a mask and gloves, because gorillas can catch all the same diseases that we can. And he went back there and had Ivan sign the book. And that little teeny green smudge in the lower right-hand corner is Ivan's thumbprint. He was finger painting that day, so he signed my book. I wish I had gotten to meet him. I didn't. And he passed away a couple years ago at the age of 50, which is very, very, very old for a gorilla. In captivity, the longest living gorilla is 53. In the wild, they might live to be 35 or so. So he had a very long life. And what was fascinating was they had a funeral. They had a memorial service for Ivan. And I went. And my husband was like, "You're flying to Atlanta to go to a gorilla funeral. Do I have this right?" I said, "Yes, I'm going." And it was so moving. It was beautiful. They had people from all over the world who had been moved by Ivan's story. They had a big wall of pictures and photos and letters from kids talking about how they remembered Ivan and how touched they were by his very strange and long voyage. And it was an extremely moving experience. I was quite amazed. So I'm going to show you one more thing. This is kind of cool. And then we have time for a few questions. This, I need to explain what you're seeing, though. This is a gorilla preserve in Africa. And what you have here is a guy who made the mistake of wearing a black shirt and having silver hair. And he's holding a camera. He's sitting very still because he is absolutely terrified. And when you see him smiling, he's absolutely terrified. In this preserve, typically, the humans get fairly close to the gorillas, and the gorillas are acclimated to human presence. But for some reason, he was sitting there, and the gorillas came to him. So suddenly, he's surrounded by a family of gorillas, including a huge silverback, which rarely, rarely happens. And you need to watch how this unfolds. What's interesting and important to know is that another way that gorillas connect with each other is by grooming. And they stick their fingers into each other's fur, and they pull out bugs, and they eat them. Yes, it's considered like the ultimate gorilla date, is you groom each other. So watch what they do to this guy's hair.
So what you feeling about, John? The silverback is just behind you. 30 centimeters behind you. And there are three babies squashed between him and you. Who knows just behind you to your right? This is the way. Touching your hair, it's being pretty, it's actually pretty. There comes a female. A black shirt of work. And the silverback, now the blue eyes are climbing up to get a closer look at your hair. She's on the back. The lips. orchard blossoms. I don't think they're going to be that interesting.
I think that's so cool because how many people get to have a gorilla kiss? I just love that. So we have time for maybe 5 minutes of questions. Who has one? And I'll try to repeat it so we can, so everybody knows what it is. Oh, that's a good question. Where did I get the names of Bob and Julie and all that? You know, most authors I know have a baby name book, and you can also go online and you can find thousands of baby names. But the Bob was named after David Letterman had, who is a comedian, had two dogs named Bob and Stan. And I told you my dog's name is Stan. And I just thought they were such funny names for a dog that I just had to use it. Julia was my daughter. And all the rest kind of came. Ivan and Burma were the real names. So, you know. Oh, and Ruby, I just thought sounded like a good name for a baby elephant. Sometimes you just randomly pick. It wasn't any. I looked up names of circus elephants, and Stella came up frequently. So that's where I got Stella. How about in the pink? I'm sorry. Say that again. I don't want to pull too far. How did I first hear? The very first time I ever heard about Ivan was that New York Times article. And then I started doing research, but honestly, I didn't hear anything more for years and years because he was still stuck at that mall for years after that. So it was kind of slow. I kind of just kept adding stuff. How about in the green there? Oh, that's a good question. Does Julia really draw like that? She's very imaginative. She likes to build, and so right now she's into like really complicated Lego stuff. So I think maybe she'll be an engineer. But no, some of that I just made up, which is the danger. I keep telling her she wants to be in another book, and I said, well, you know, I have to make stuff up, and people will think that's really you. So it's a funny thing about you. Typically, if you're an author, you don't use people you know or family members because you have to make stuff up to make it interesting, right? How about in the red? Do I have a husband named George? I have a husband named Michael. And Michael Grant is an author. He writes scary books for older kids, a series called The Gone Series and some other things. And it's so funny because he writes gigantically fat, enormous books, and he writes really fast. So we're both working in the house, and I'll write like, you know, three lines and think I had a good day. And he'll come down and he'll have written like 25 pages. So it's really not fair, but it's useful because we can talk about plot because we're both writers. So it's kind of like having an in-house, you know, advisor. How about in the green?
What are your favorite types of books?
What are my favorite types of books? Well, you want to know the truth? Listen, I don't want, the teachers could just cover their ears for a minute. I really didn't like to read when I was a kid at all. And it took me a long time to become a reader, and with the sole exception of this book, I really loved it as a kid, called Charlotte's Web, which some of you, I'm sure, have read. And I loved animal fantasies. So now I tend to read books that are more imaginative. And I read kids' books all the time, even though I'm a grown-up, partly because it's my job, and very often I know the authors. Sometimes I even read books before they come out, and I will write comments on them called blurbs. So I get to see books a lot of times before they come out, which is kind of fun. But mostly just because I love books for kids. They're so much more fun than grown-up books. Kid books can have anything happen, you know, and I love that. So how about in the blue?
Oh,
you're kidding. kidding. That is so funny. I met a family once, and they had every single animal name in their family. They had a Stella, they had a Ruby, they had an Ivan, believe it or not. It was so funny. That's really unusual. How about in the red? Yeah, you right. Yeah. No, you. Yeah.
My dad's name is also Michael.
Oh, it's a wonderful name. It's a name you hear a lot. And the funny thing is, when Michael and I were writing, and we did what's called ghostwriting, we had pretend names. They're called pseudonyms. And my favorite one was, we did this series for Disney about Aladdin. Remember the movie Aladdin? And we had to make up a name. So our name was A.R. Plum. And the editor made it up, and what it is mixed up letters called an anagram of rub a lamp. So sometimes names are just, actually my husband's real name is Michael Reynolds, but he writes as Michael Grant. So a lot of times that happens with authors. When I wrote Animorphs, this is interesting, I would love to get your opinion. I was K.A. Applegate, and I think maybe they did that because they thought that boys don't like to read books that are written by women. So what do you guys think? Do you just show of hands, would you, if you're a boy, would you read a book if it was by a woman? Would it matter to you? See, I think they're crazy. But anyway, that's how I was K.A. instead of Katherine. How about two more questions in the green? Oh, that's so funny. Kathy Appelt is actually a friend of mine, and she also writes animal fantasies. We have the same agent, and she lives in Texas. But because our names are so similar, and we write the same kinds of books, we're often mistaken for each other. And I can't tell you how many times I've had somebody come up to me when I'm doing a book signing and say, I loved your book, The Underneath, and they think I'm Kathy Appelt. Sometimes I explain that I'm not. Sometimes I just pretend to be Kathy because it's easier. And she does the same thing. She was at a library recently, and the same thing happened to her. So it's funny. It's hard to keep track of authors' names because there are so many of us. How about one more?
When Ivan was in the black domain, when he banged on it, how did it not break?
Oh, isn't that interesting? When he hit the glass, how did it not break? Well, at Zoo Atlanta, and I'm pretty sure it was Zoo Atlanta, it actually did break. And it wasn't Ivan who did it, but there were a bunch of people watching. I think they actually have film of it, or you can certainly see pictures of it. One of the gorillas actually managed to put a crack in the glass. But it's reinforced about a million times over, so it's not a big danger. So, but they're incredibly, amazingly strong animals. And you sometimes, even little chimps, you know, who look so small and delicate by comparison, are amazingly strong. So you forget how muscular they are. I have to thank you for, I want to tell you something while I've been sitting here. I've been sneakily looking at all these beautiful projects you guys made, and I cannot wait. I'm going to take lots of photos, and I'm going to sit through and look at each one, because that is so special that you went to all that trouble and made all this, and the welcome posters, and just the incredible friendly welcome I've had has really been remarkable. So thank you so much for letting me come and talk.
Well, Catherine, we just wanted to thank you for coming. Oh. It's been awesome. And we can't thank you enough for making that trip. And we loved the one and only Ivan.
Oh, thank you
so
much.
Let's give it one more big round of applause.
Thank you.